learned naive Bayes classifier before, and it is related to Bayesian belief network. Recall that in naive Bayes classifier, all variables are related to a class variable. So those are the individual variables, and this is a class variable. It could take any one of the class labels that we have provided. And we have assumption that says given the class, all those variables are conditionally independent. This naive Bayes classifier is actually a very simple Bayesian belief network. The network is so simple and it only have two levels with one class label that's all the other variables relates to. A Bayesian belief network are structured more complex. For example, we have the screen is not big enough, so I have to reduce this. I have a larger picture of this towards the end of this section. But when we diagnose printer troubleshoot a printer, many factors could lead to different kinds of errors. So there's different variables that might cause different symptoms. Intermediate symptoms cause other symptoms and various printer errors. So this is a more complex belief network where we can see that with this complexity, the assumption looks different. And this is a special case of the assumption of the network. And we will talk about assumption more. But to have a little bit clearer picture, and I made this small network. See, there's five variables. Whether a high school student studied hard, that might contribute to whether he's going to get a SAT score of 2400. And if whether he's going to get the SAT score, a full score, affects the chance that he might have a chance to meet with the president. When he has or not a high SAT score, his parents may be happy enough to buy him a new TV. And maybe his mother might have a raise of salary, and that may also contribute to a decision to buy a TV or not. So in a graph like this, what can we do with it? If we know those conditional probability distribution, we will be able to infer, given a student studies hard, what's the chance for the student meet with the president. We can also infer, if the student met with president, what's the chance that he has studied hard. We could also infer, if we buy a TV, what's the influence between mother and salary change and the student's SAT score. So have a Bayesian belief network allow us to make many kind of inference. However, I want to mention that Bayesian belief network is just one graph model. It does not cover all the scenarios. Other common well-known graph models include Markov models. We in this class won't have time to cover a Markov model, but if you study graph models, you will be exposed to a set of other graph models that use probability to make inferences. Okay, so now we can now introduce some formal terminology that allow us to study networks better. So as we see the example before, a Bayesian belief network is a directed, so the arrow says what cause something else. Study hard might cause you to have a full SAT score, for example. It's acyclic. Acyclic means that you will not have a loop. So the influence is one directional. You cannot go from x0, x2, x3, then back to x1 and back to x0. Bayesian belief network does not allow that kind of circle. Some other networks do. So this directed acyclic graph encodes the dependence relations among this set of variables. So anything cause another thing or influence has direct influence of another variable will have an arc in between those two variables. This variable x0 does not directly affect xy. Students study hard and the parents race has a salary raise probably does not have that direct relation, so we don't have an arc or edge linking x0 to x1, right? So the nodes are the random variables, and we said that the arcs or edges asserts the dependence or causal relations between child-parent variables. Yes, child. So this is child, this is parent. So parent caused child, okay? And based on that, we can see that x1 and x2 are parents of x3, and x2 is a parent of x4, x0 is a parent of x2. Based on the child-parent relations, we can actually derive other relations, ancestor and descendant. So anything, ancestor and descendant note covers child-parent variables and relations, but ancestor covers anything that's below this chain. So x0 would be an ancestor for x2 and x4. x0 is also an ancestor of x2 and x3. So if you and a descendant similar, I'm sure you can figure out that, but descendant is on the same effect chain. So from x0, x2, x3, x3 would be considered a descendant of x0. x2 is also a descendant of x0. x2 in particular is also a child of x0. Okay, and the sibling nodes is similarly defined, modeled our human family relations. When you have the siblings at the nodes that share parents, okay, so x3 and x4 are siblings and they share this parent x2. The parent, ancestor, descendant, sibling, this set of terminology is used in any tree structure. So those are general terminologies. So with that being covered, and we can now talk a little bit more about what kind of things can be modeled by Bayesian belief network. And we have looked at the chain rule before, remember? It's fairly complex when you need to compute the joint probability of something. The chain rule says you have to do this. That will require you to figure out lots of probabilities among different sets of variables. Without any assumption, execute on chain rule can make the computation really complex. So most of the model graph models has assumptions to simplify computation. So Bayesian belief network also have assumptions, and one example that we have seen is reflected on the naive Bayesian. But the assumption would allow a Bayesian belief network to encode a joint distribution simplified, can be simply computed as a product of local conditional distribution. By local, we mean that we only care about this X and its parents, okay? So this actually, when you study this a little bit, we're going to do that study in the next slide, we will realize that the assumption assumed by Bayesian belief network is a node in a Bayesian network is conditionally independent of its non-sibling nodes if its parents are known. We used to have lots of questions regarding this assumption, so I have made this slide to show. Hopefully it's going to clarify this a little bit better. Can I make it a bit so it fits into this screen? Okay. So what we see here, our little small network, without any assumption, okay, if we just simply apply the chain rule, if we don't know all those directions or edges, we just know those five variables might actually interact with each other. In order to compute a joint distribution like this, so x variable x0 takes the value of x0, variable x1 takes the value of small x1. So if we want to compute a joint distribution, we apply the chain rule, which says we first compute the probability of x0 occurs, then times the probability when x0 occurs, x1 also occur, and times the probability when x0 and x1 occurs, x2 occurs. So this chains down to the end of the last variable. When all other x0 to x3 occurs, what's the chance for us to get x4? So this is the chain rule. Then we will contrast this chain rule, the formula derived from chain rule, with the formula that Bayesian belief network tell us to do. So to compute a joint probability, a Bayesian network tell us that we simply need to take the product of the local conditional probability. So this is what we're going to get. Ignore the gray, the parts that's in gray at this time. So to compute this, follow this formula. This is what we did. We have probability of x starting from x, the first x. So here we're starting from, the formula says start from 1, but our first is actually x0, so we start from x0. So x0 conditioned on its parent. X0 is here conditioned on the parent, no parents, so there's no condition. So probability of x0 times x1 conditioned on its parents. X1 does not have parent. Again, we have just x0, x1 alone. Ignore the gray part for now. And the third term would be x2 conditioned on its parent, x2 conditioned on its parent, which is x0. So x2 conditioned on x0. So follow this formula, you can see that our computation is now this, okay? Now we can take back those grayed out elements. Those are the ones that was in the chain rule formula. So compare this to, in this one formula, we can see what has been simplified. X0 is gone, x0 is gone. So from look at this term, compare it to this. If those two terms are equivalent, are the same, which tells us x1 and x0 are independent, right? So x1 and 0 are independent. Our graph says there's no link here. This term alone, there may be other things indicate those two things have relations by some other terms. But we can also study, but what we observed here is only the parents, when we compute a single probability, we only need to take care of its parents. We don't need to consider all other variables. And also look at, examine the variables one by one. So what we see here, starting from x0, looking at this formula, only x0 and x2 have some relation, not independent. So we can see x0, x2 are not independent because there is an arc. Of course, they're not independent. X0 calls x2, right? So this, x2 is a sibling of x0, and x0 is a child of x0. X0 is a parent of x2. And now we look at the second x1, in which term we see a relation. X1 x1 and x3 are not independent, x1 and x3. Yeah, again, they have these relations. And look at x2. x2 is not independent with x0 here. x2 is also not independent with x3 here. And x2 is also not independent with x4. So they're dependent. There's a dependence relations. So x2 and x4. So again, what we see here is given the parents, a node in the Bayesian network is conditionally independent, conditioned on the parents, conditional independent to its non-descendant node. So x2 is actually, the formula tells us x2 is dependent, has dependence relations with x0 and x4, right? Because they're in a chain of a common chain of effect. So this causes this, and this causes that. However, when we know x2, when the parents x2, parents of x4, when x2 is known, x4 is no longer dependent with x0. So this term tells us when x2 is known, x2 is a parent of x4, x4 is no longer dependent with x0. The reason I want to emphasize, the reason that we can, the reason this term is the same as this term is because with the BBN assumptions, x3, x1, x0 are all independent of x4. Therefore, having them or not as a condition make no difference for the probability for x4 to occur. Okay, so what this tells us that given x2, which is the parent of x4, given x2, x0, x1, and x3 are all independent from x4. So this is exactly the assumption that we described earlier. So this node is conditional independent of all its non-sibling node given its parents. Given its parents, x4 is independent of x0, x1, and x3 as what we have seen here. So these assumptions allow the simplification from chain rule to the BBN joint probability formula. It dramatically simplifies the computation. Well, not all variables in our life, the data mining task that we wanted to process, has this kind of dependence patterns. Many situations does not fit this assumption. So BBN is useful to model those scenarios when their variables actually roughly conform to the assumption and make this equation valid. So examples, for example, printer diagnosis, many other equipment diagnosis scenarios, medical diagnosis. So there's causal relations, known causal relations, and we have pretty good way to estimate the probabilities. And those are the scenarios that the BBN actually have shown to be quite effective. So another point that I want to make, when you have a large enough graph like this, to decide whether two variables in a BBN is independent actually is not as simple as look at the local scenario, because this variable might lead to another variable which might influence another variable. So the influence, even though x3 and x4 are not directly linked with the arc, there might be indirect dependence exist between these two variables. So to decide whether two variables in a BBN is independent, there is a whole set of methodology We're not going to cover those. As you can tell, we don't have a class of time, a semester of time to discuss this. I just want to give you some pointers if you're interested to study more. It's called deseparation. It's built on the three scenarios that we see in graph like this. Effect chain, what we see here, effect chain from x0, x2, x4. This is effect chain. This is also a effect chain. And also common cause. So these two things are caused by x2. So this is common cause scenario. And the common effect scenario. X1, X2 cause the same effect. So this is a common effect scenario. Those three cases covers all the scenarios that we see in a Bayesian belief network. And building on those variable dependencies scenarios, there is a theory called deseparation. And using deseparation methodology, we can actually analyze a graph to tell whether two variables in a BDN is independent or not. Okay, but this is not really related. It's not related to what we're going to discuss next. So if that's confusing to you, just forget them. Okay. So we just discussed the assumptions, the topology of the network, but there is one piece, a critical piece of information that we have not discussed that's a part of any Bayesian belief network, is the conditional probability tables. So earlier we said that given the chance students study hard, we can infer what's the chance for student to have a chance to see the president. Those computation is possible because the Bayesian belief network for each every node, so here we have five nodes, we have five table. Each every node have a conditional probability table. So B and E does not have parent, therefore we only have its marginal distribution table. But for all the other nodes that has a parent, we have conditional distribution table conditioned on its parents. So for example, this J node is conditioned on the A node. So we have this probability J occurs when A occurs. Different values of J occur conditioned on different values of A. Okay. So this is going to be the example that we're going to use for the following slides. Borrowed from some existing slides. Many BBN networks use these simple examples to illustrate how inferences are done, and we're going to use the same example. So B here is burglary. Burglary and earthquake could all trigger alarm, okay? When alarm sound, Jack and Mary could call their parent. Well, this is like, I don't know, like a COVID scenario. Children are at home, parents have to go out and work when the alarm sounds that the children have to call. So the graph is made this way. It may not reflect what you understand of situation. You might think that, oh, when Jack calls, Mary will not call because Mary saw Jack called. This is not what this graph tells us. The graph actually based on the Bayesian assumption, given the parents, A is known, given alarm sounded, the probability for M to call is independent of all its non-sibling code. So it's independent of all of E, B, J variables. Okay, so this is what the graph tells us. You can imagine that Jake, Mary and Jack are actually in separate room concentrating on their online courses. So they don't even know if the other children will call. They will just call immediately to tell their parents that something's wrong in the house. Okay. Okay. So the last point that we want to make graph in this slide is compute the joint probability. Recall that earlier when we do the review, we made a point that when you know the joint distribution, you actually know the full distribution, because from joint distribution you can compute any conditional distribution. You can find given burglary happened, what's the chance for Mary to call? Given the earthquake happened, what's the chance for Jack to call? Okay. The key feature of Bayesian belief network is to give you a simplified way to compute this joint distribution using this formula. Okay. So in here we apply that formula on this example to find a joint probability of one scenario. So the B and the plus and minus signs here to are basically what's modeled here. It says whether certain things occurred or not. So all these variables that we modeled here are binary variables. Whether burglary happens or not, so plus B or minus B. Earthquake happen or not, plus E or minus E. So the scenario that we have here is burglary happened, no earthquake, alarm sounded, Jack did not call, Mary called. Okay, so what's the probability for this scenario to happen? Again, apply that formula that we first start with B because it doesn't have the parent. So B is just by itself, and C, not C, E. E again does not have a parent. We need to go through each of the variables that's modeled in the graph following this effect chain. Okay. So what we have here is B and not C, and given B, sorry, E, it's E because my eyesight are really not very good those days. The third term here we have is when B happens and earthquake not happen, A happens. So this here, B happens, earthquake does not happen, alert happens, what's the probability? So the formula tells us for this A variable, we need to find the probability for A to occur when certain scenarios, certain B and E values were taken. So this is our third term. The fourth term, we go down to J. J, again, we only need to condition on its parent, right? So we don't have J, but we have A. So this is our fourth term. The last term is on M, which is our scenario tells that A happened. So A happened, alert sounded, and the Mary called. So this is our probability. And as you can tell, each of this probability can be taken from the table. Okay. So those conditional probability table are critically important, obviously. It's indispensable in a Bayesian belief network. Using this formula, we can easily compute a joint probability for this scenario to happen.